When I go on tour, I actually only ever take one guitar with me. This guitar, she's called Wilma. She is a Loudon guitar. They're made in Ireland, just north of the border in Ireland, by George Loudon and his beautiful family and a few master craftsmen that he has there. And they're incredible guitars. It's strange because they're incredibly lightly built. Everything is, the top's very thin. The bracing is very light. Everything's very thin. When you get a Loudon in a shop, you pick it up, it weighs less than all the other guitars. But they're also incredibly tough. I don't know quite how or why. I mean, they're just beautifully built. So they're incredibly tough. And I only use this one guitar. I mean, it's worn in such a way that I use all these textures on the wood to get different sounds. That's not essential to do my style of guitar playing. You don't have to scratch up your guitar. Please don't do that. But yeah, so I just use this one guitar and it's never ever failed or let me down. I also use I use a brand of strings called Newtone strings, made in Derbyshire by Malcolm and Neil, who are just, you know, Derbyshire lads. And they hand wind these strings. They stand there smoking a pipe all day, hand winding strings. And I've never broken one. They seem to be unbreakable. I've never broken one on a gig ever, you know? And and I do all this crazy retuning as well, but they never break. So, and I use mostly Boss effects pedals, and everybody who knows about the Boss pedals knows that you can take a hammer to those things, just smack it, and it won't break. So I tend to use good quality gear, good kind of stuff that's really physically well made. So yeah, I don't worry about taking multiple guitars or backup effects pedals or anything like that on tour with me. And sometimes I guess that's a bit of a risk because I'm in China or something or Africa, and it's not that easy to get a replacement Boss pedal. But yeah, I don't worry. It's not something I ever worry about, yeah. And the fact that I'm playing in lots of different tunings on a gig and I have to retune between every song, it's just meant that I've had to develop things to say to audiences, so I have a lot of banter and a lot of little stories that I tell while I'm retuning my guitar. So hopefully people don't really notice that I'm actually retuning my guitar because I'm saying funny things to them. But I am pretty extreme with the tunings, and sometimes I just have to stand there and tune quietly because sometimes tuning is hard, and so the audience just have to kind of be patient for a moment. But that's okay, you know. I have a song that I play, which maybe I should play for you guys today. I don't know. I hadn't thought about it, but it's an older song of mine, and it's quite a popular one. It tends to get requested a lot. But it's about my first girlfriend that I ever had. I'm from Blackpool originally, and I guess I was like 17. My first kind of proper girlfriend, you know. And this girl, she was a chav. I don't mean that as any term of disrespect at all. But when I was a kid, it wasn't a dirty word then anyway, when I was a kid, you basically, teenage society was strictly divided along tribal lines. You had to be either a chav or a mosher, or you were nothing. And these words, they change, like you can be a townie or you can be whatever. And the mosher could be like the alternative kid or emo or whatever, or goth, whatever. But you know, tends to be, you get these two kinds of kids and it's very tribal. So I was obviously you can tell in my tattoos and stuff, I was a mosher. So it was a forbidden love, crossing the mosher-chav divide, frowned upon by friends and even family, very much like the situation of Romeo and Juliet, except that actually her family was a lot more violent than Juliet's family. And the song is a country waltz called Gloria. So maybe if I don't play it for you today, people can Google it. They can look it up on YouTube or whatever. So that's my favorite funny story. I use these banjo tuners, special machine heads. Sadly, obviously, to get these tuners, you have to vandalize a banjo, but that is actually a victimless crime in many people's eyes. These tuners are called Scruggs pegs, and the first person I saw use these was Billy Connolly on TV, playing his banjo. Billy Connolly, the stand-up comedian, not everybody knows. He's a really great banjo player, but he did this tuning trick. You know, while he's in the middle of a song, it's like, what's going on there? And I had to find out about them. And then I've heard Adrian Legg, the guitar player, fantastic English fingerstyle guitar player. And as far as I know, he's the first guitar player to try these pegs on a guitar. And I bought some after seeing him use them, and they're absolutely amazing fun. They are called Scruggs pegs because they're named after a guy called Earl Scruggs, who's a bluegrass banjo player who died just last year, ripe old age. And he invented this trick of retuning, and you have these magic pegs to do it with. And the person who makes these pegs is called Bill Keith, and they're called Keith pegs. And they're all handmade in Woodstock, New York. They're very expensive as far as machine heads go. I don't know if you could spend more on machine heads, but they are, for me, the amount of fun they bring, they're really, really worth it. And I use them. So to me, you can create really kind of almost ethereal sounds with them, and they're really, really beautiful. But they're great. People should definitely, I don't know, it's funny. I'm talking to Loudon at the moment about making a signature model guitar, and we're debating whether to put these on the signature guitars. I don't know if we're going to or not. So we'll weigh it up. But I really hope that more guitar players get into using them because they're a lot of fun. So yeah, my pickup system inside the guitar, it's quite complicated, and it's really different to the way that you amplify, you know, an electric guitar. I suppose that kind of goes without saying. But the thing with an electric guitar is you have, because I'm assuming a lot of people know about pickups on electric guitar and what they do. So on a Strat, you have three different pickups, and that gives you three different sounds. I mean, people know it's more complex than that. But basically you've got a pickup here, which sounds a bit kind of more woody and bassy, and a pickup here, which is really trebly, and you switch between them. On the acoustic guitar, it's really different. What you're trying to do is actually get that bass sound and that trebly sound that all come from the guitar and actually have them all going at once. And one pickup alone, that nobody's made a pickup on its own, certainly in my opinion, that does that, that can create all of those sounds. So I have a Fishman Rare Earth blend system. This is a humbucker in the sound hole. It's a specially made humbucker for acoustic guitars. It's not, you couldn't just take one off a Les Paul and stick it in, it wouldn't work. This pickup, I can show you on its own, sounds like this. So it sounds quite nice, it's quite warm, it's quite rich, there's not much, there is some treble there, but also because it's a magnetic pickup, it doesn't pick up any of the percussion sounds, because, you know, science fans, wood's not magnetic. So let me turn that pickup off and put the next one on. So this rare earth blend system, it comes with a microphone actually attached to the humbucker. And the microphone sounds like this. It's a completely different sound. It's much quieter on the strings, but the microphone picks up all of these noises. It's just one microphone. People think I must have lots of them, but you only need one. The reason it sounds different when I hit in different places is because the acoustic guitar is an awesome percussion instrument, and it just does sound different. So that's the microphone, and then I have a pickup under the bridge as well, which is a little bit more like you'd get in a standard electroacoustic guitar, and on its own again. Now this one you can hear sounds a lot treblier than the humbucker did. You get really high harmonics out of there. What happens with acoustic guitar is rather than switching between those like you would on electric guitar, you run them all at once. So let me turn them all back on again. And that way, by running them all at the same time, you get this really rich three-dimensional sound. It's got bass, it's got treble, it's got the percussion, it's got what your acoustic guitar players refer to as air, which means that it doesn't sound like you're plugged into the guitar, into your ear. You can hear the air almost breathing between you and the guitar. So it sounds a bit more alive and a bit more natural. Thankfully, this company's making incredible electronics now, like Fishman do, and you can get this awesome, big, rich, and still acoustic sound out of the guitar. So that's pretty much how my picker system works, and they come down three separate cables here into three different little EQ boxes on my pedal board, which are these Boss parametric EQ pedals, and then I mix them all together. And that's what on the pedal board still, and that's what comes out. So that's the pickups. It's pretty complicated. But it's worth the effort to me. The venues that I play are too big to where I could just kind of play through an acoustic amp straight to the audience. So usually I'm going into the PA system, but I use an amp on stage, so that's mostly for me to hear. And I use one at home as well, and that's a Trace Elliott. They've just because they were the first company to bring out acoustic amps, and they've just relaunched a whole new redesigned range, and they're really, really good. So I use a Trace Elliott acoustic combo, and I've only ever had the opportunity to play one gig with it, because most of the places I play are a bit too big, but I did a gig in a primary school for my niece, her primary school. They dragged me in to go and play to about 300 kids from the age of, what would it be, primary school? It's like five up to about 10 or 11. I was absolutely terrified. That's the most scary gig I've ever done. But it's the only gig where the audience have all said thank you in unison at the end. And I got thank you letters as well. That doesn't happen very often, actual letters. I used the Trace Elliott for that gig on its own. That's the only chance I've had to play somewhere small enough to just use an amp. But yeah, I use it all the time on stage and at home. So it's it's a good thing. Down here on the floor, I have a bunch of effects pedals. So I think this is from my background as an electric guitarist that I really love stomp boxes, you know? I really, really do. Most of my peers who are acoustic guitar players, they don't really use pedals. They tend to use rack mount stuff or, you know, rack mount preamps and blenders and stuff. And I just like the boxes. So yeah, I have the EQ pedals here. So they're not very exciting because all they do is just tweak the tone. They don't actually add any fun special effects. But they are vitally important, probably the most important ones. I have a line selector here, Boss line selector, which is the Swiss Army knife of pedals. And that I use that to blend the different pickup signals into one signal. I have overdrive. Ooh, let's turn it down a bit. And because I'm not using an electric guitar amp. My overdrive pedal is an amp simulator as opposed to just an overdrive pedal. So it gives that kind of, it sounds a little bit more like a guitar amp. Otherwise, if you're just plugging an overdrive pedal straight into a PA system, they don't usually sound that great. So I use an amp simulator one. I have my Boss OC3, which adds a layer of kind of, I've tuned really low my guitar, and this bottom string is a 68 gauge. Currently that's around a B flat note, I think. So I tune really, really low. And then I add the octave pedal as well underneath. And bass is very, very addictive, I find. And you keep wanting more and more. So that's my octave. And then I have some reverb. And echo as well. And I do change the reverb and the echo for different songs. I like to have different reverbs and different echoes for different songs. So I'm often, as well as retuning my guitar between songs, I'm on the floor scrabbling around, changing the settings on my pedals. I guess the important thing to notice, just because I mentioned all the pickup systems, is that overdrive and the octave, they're only on the humbucker sound. If I was to add overdrive to a little condenser microphone inside the guitar, it would just feed back and sound awful. So that one's just on the humbucker, and so is the octave pedal. Whereas the echo and the reverb, that happens to the whole sound. So all the pickups go through those. Otherwise, I'd have reverb on the strings, but not on the percussion, and that would sound, again, very, very strange. So yeah, needs a little bit of thought going into it if you're going to use pedals on acoustic guitar. So me and Wilma, we have a kind of romantic love story between us. This guitar, I went to see Nick Harper, who I mentioned earlier, and he's had this sound, and it was massive. It's a wall of noise, you know, and electric guitar, going back to electric guitar after playing the acoustic that's got such a huge amount of bass and all that sparkly treble, the electric guitar actually sounds kind of weak, especially if I play somebody's guitar and it's got 10s on it. I'm used to using 15s. It's like, you know, it's like a toy or something. So I went to see Nick Harper and he was playing this guitar and it just sounded massive. And so I went to ask him what it was and I wrote it down. It's this Loudon guitar, and I tried his guitar after the gig as well, and it was, you know, it's so good. You know, I'd never heard anything like it. It's a big, warm sound. So I went home and I looked in the back of a guitarist magazine to try and find a secondhand Loudon, because he said that, you know, they're quite expensive. I couldn't afford one, so I was trying to find a secondhand one in the classifieds at the back of the guitar magazine. This is like really about 2000 when I got this guitar, I guess. So it's a long time ago, and there were no Loudons in the classified section. I didn't know that they're handmade guitars. I thought, you know, it's like Fender or Gibson. There's thousands, millions of these things, you know, but they don't make that many, so it's not that easy to find one. So I looked in through that magazine away. I looked in the previous month's magazine in the classifieds. Still no Loudons. Next previous month's, still no Loudons. I went through my whole stack of back issues and eventually I found a Loudon and looked at the front of the magazine. It's like, oh no, this is 18 months old. So I thought, well, never mind. I phoned this guy up and I said, oh, you had this Loudon guitar for sale. Have you still got it? And he said, yeah, no, nobody bought it. And I didn't recognize the area code of his phone number. So I said, oh, where do you live? I don't recognize, you know, your number or anything. He said, oh, I live in Winchester. And I was living in Leeds. And Leeds is quite a long way from Winchester, and I didn't have a car even at the time. So I happened to speak to my dad later that night. My dad's been taking me for guitar lessons since I was a little kid. He knows about guitars a little bit. So anyway, I was telling him about, oh yeah, fancy one of these Loudon guitars. I've seen one in a classifieds in a magazine, but it's in Winchester. I don't know how to get there. And he said, oh, that's funny. I'm going to Winchester tomorrow. So there you go. That's the fate. He went and picked up the guitar for me, and you know, he checked it didn't have any extra holes in it or anything. And so yeah, that's how me and Wilma came together, really. Yeah, so I chose it for the sound, and I guess I've stayed with the guitar partly for the sound, partly because they're so playable. They have this really kind of, the neck is just gorgeous. If you picked up this neck on a PRS or something, electric guitar, you'd think, oh, it's so nice. You know, it's not a big chunky acoustic guitar neck or a little kind of broom handle acoustic guitar neck you sometimes get. And I guess I've stuck with it as well because it just survives my constant abuse and just complete monogamist guitar wise. I'm just stuck with this, stuck with Wilma. She's stuck with me. Ha 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 ha.